Hey guys, it's Nicole, a long time no see. I'm here at the NTI 2017 Critical Care Conference here in Houston, Texas. And my Airbnb has no TV, so I figured I'd film a video now that, you know, I have the time and I am alone in an Airbnb. One of you amazing viewers out there had a question regarding dealing with a preceptor not meeting your expectations. I'm currently a preceptor. I had, you know, that great role opportunity, and this has happened before. You aren't the only one this has happened to. Please understand that when you are an orientee, whether it's med surg or psych or labor and delivery or ICU, you're going to have moments of fear. It's a new atmosphere. You know, the patient population is new to you. Fear is expected to some level. But what's not expected is you not getting what you need out of your preceptor. Your preceptor is there to be a resource to you. And if that relationship isn't reciprocal, there's a problem there. My first tip for you would be to just speak to your preceptor about what he or she is lacking. Sometimes programs only request evaluations one way, from preceptor to orientee. Meaning the preceptor is always evaluating the orientee on their objectives and their job performance and how they're doing taking care of patients. And that's great. Obviously, that's very necessary. But I would recommend any educator to also let the orientee evaluate the preceptor, because often that orientee is drowning. He or she is struggling and they don't really know when to bring it up. I've seen many scenarios where a GN will not be passed because they aren't performing, but it's due to a lack of direction, so to speak. When you're a new person, I only know what you tell me. So if you don't tell me something, boo, I don't know. And yes, it's my fault, but is it really my fault? I mean, I don't know anything. So you're yelling at me about something that I don't know. You should be looking inward and finding out if you educated me properly. Because when it comes to GNs, you start from the bottom and work your way up. Even with nurses transitioning from med surg to ICU, ICU to labor and delivery, these are specialized fields. You need that experience and that training to help you along the way. And if you don't have that, that is what your preceptor is supposed to bring to the table. So if you're not getting that, the first step would be to talk to your preceptor. It's going to be a difficult conversation, but trust me, not having a job or income is more difficult on you. Because please understand, if they don't pass you, where I work at anyway, find a job in 30 days or you owe us $12,000. That's how that works. Because where I work at anyway, the contract is signed before you even start training. Yes, they want that contract, that two-year contract, locked and loaded before you start training. So if something happens where you're not performing and it's not working out for the floor, you're not meeting their expectations, please believe there ain't no backup job for you. I mean, I don't know where you work at. Please inquire about that. But where I work at, I'll give you some leads, babe, but you got 30 days or you're terminated because you cannot work here. So figure that out. With that in mind, I recommend you stand up for yourself and, again, talk to your preceptor. If that's not working, if that first point of contact isn't working, talk to your educator. And you don't have to get really uppity with the he said, she said, I don't like them, they don't like me. You need to give measurable examples of where your preceptor is failing you. For example, the preceptor was yelling at me about a vasopressor titration we never went over on patient such and such on this day. I didn't know the material, but the preceptor had not educated me on that. You have to give measurable examples. A lot of educators would take you more seriously if you can give exact examples instead of you just saying a person doesn't like me because they hate men or they hate women or whatever your excuse is. You have to present your case in the most professional way to be heard. If your educator isn't listening, I say go to your unit manager, because you will owe that $12,000. Nobody else is under contract except you. If you have a terrible preceptor, they'll just continue to be terrible. But they got a job. They're out of the contract, usually out, hopefully, out of that contract window. So even though they're terrible, they keep their job. And you're the one, what is the phrase? Ass out? I don't know the phrase, but you stuck. So if you know that, if it is all on your shoulders, you need to be more proactive and less reactive in your education. Every day you should come to work in your training with, today I want to learn about A-lines. I want to go over this. Some preceptors are like, ooh, wing it. Do your thing. I'm going to chill over here and watch a movie. No. Because trust me, there will be an opportunity where you mess up and you get yelled at because that preceptor is too relaxed. I mean, I love a very casual and, you know, personal relationship with the GNs that I train. But please understand, this is about business of taking care of people. Take it seriously because I'm evaluating you seriously. And if you don't make it, that's on you. I got a job, boo. So keep that in mind. Be proactive. Have daily objectives. You know, I don't know where you work at, but I evaluate my GNs weekly. So if something isn't working out, I give them measurable, you know, situations and exact examples. This patient, you kept that systolic, you know, around 200 for 20 minutes. Don't do that. Here's my expectation. You keep that blood pressure systolic between 90 and 160. I have very clear cut parameters with my GNs. And if you need that, ask your preceptor. But if you don't ask, you don't know. And it's on your shoulders to stay there. If you really want it and you want to stay there, you're going to have to be proactive and sometimes motivate the preceptor to help you obtain that knowledge and critical thinking mindset. So that's my two cents. You're going to have to do a lot of talking, do a lot of explaining, and at some point, sadly, defending yourself, but you have to do it because it's up to you to maintain that contract and perform as expected. Because if not, you wasted an opportunity and now you owe a hospital or a community hospital or outpatient facility some coin. So think about that when you're stressed out and you just want to quit and you're under contract. Am I really giving this my all? Have I really used all the resources? Should I talk to this person or that person? Because you getting heated and quitting a job, it's not smart. Whether you're a GN or a veteran nurse, you have to think about the end game, financially, professionally, everythingly. So I hope this video helps you all out there who are having issues with your preceptor. Please communicate. Please come with objectives and a plan of care regarding your education process, really. Questions or comments for me, as always, put those below. Thanks for watching, guys, and have a great, great evening. Take care. Bye. I want you to appreciate the fact that I shaved my beard before this video. I got real nice and close. All the old lady whiskers are gone. And I do that for you. And for me too. I feel like if I become intubated for a long period of time and my coworkers or my husband would happen to see the amount of chin whiskers that I have, they wouldn't understand how that happened. It's because I shave every day. Am I the only person who has old lady whiskers? I'm in my mid-30s. And yes, folks, I have old lady whiskers. One day they just popped up. It was like I was cruising through life, whisker-free. And then one day I had one of those witch chin whiskers that was curly. It was telling a tale. And then the next day it had a friend on the other side. And then the next day, more friends came to the party who were uninvited. And now we're at about 8 chin whiskers. So your girl be shaving every day because it's not really a good look. It's super not a good look.